My name is Sam, and I'm an amateur student filmmaker from the South Side of Glasgow. I live in that house there with my family at the gates of the Old Cathcart Cemetery. This is what it looked like about 120 years ago. It served as the home of the groundskeeper for many years until it was left abandoned. My parents renovated it about 10 years ago, and I've been lucky to live there. During the COVID-19 pandemic of 2020, I stumbled across a community Facebook page called the Friends of Cathcart Cemetery. They had created an interactive map with 57 notable burials, most of which I'd never heard of. I wanted to find out more, so I grabbed a camera and I took a walk with somebody that knows what they're talking about to get their thoughts and discover some stories. Peter's a local award-winning author whose latest book, A Tomb with a View, was partly inspired by this place, and it's fair to say he's a true cemetery enthusiast.
When I first moved to this area, which would have been about 10, 12, 13 years ago, I started to go walking in the cemetery because it's so close to my house, and I noticed at the top of the hill, or near the top of the hill, the grave that said Mark Sheridan, comedian, upon it. And I was massively intrigued by this because I thought, I'd never seen the word comedian on a stone before. I wonder who that person was. So I looked into him, and it turns out that Mark Sheridan was a music hall star from the northeast of England. And amazingly, he's the reason that we all know the song I Do Like to Be Beside the Seaside. It was his 1911 recording of that song that made it, you know, nationally, internationally famous and become a sort of folk song.
Oh, I do like to be beside the sea. I do like to be beside the sea. I do like to stroll along the prom, prom, prom.
And then I wondered, how is it that that guy is buried on the hill behind my house? So I looked into the newspaper stories of his death in the Mitchell Library in Glasgow. And it turns out that very sadly, he took his own life while on tour in the city and in Kelvingrove Park, in fact, and was buried a few days later in Cathcart Cemetery. And that was really the acorn from which the book began, because it made me think, that is an incredible story. And I bet there are stories just as incredible in cemeteries all around Britain.
Mark Sheridan turned out to be the tip of the iceberg of interesting stories, and I soon learned that he was not the only famous musician within these walls. This is the unfortunately topo grave of the so-called Queen of Melody, Jessie Nevin McLachlan. In 1899, using a gramophone, Jessie became the first ever singer to record a Gaelic song. Jessie died in 1916 and left behind a distinguished career, performing all around the world to fans, Queen Victoria amongst others. As you can imagine, her funeral was well attended, and two personal friends led the cortege to the sound of their bagpipes. She was a pioneer for Scottish music, and I hope that her grave can be rescued so that she can be deservedly remembered. The cemetery is only 2 miles from all three previous locations of Hampden, Scotland's national football stadium. So it was no surprise to learn that the cemetery is the resting place of some of Scottish football's early founders. In late 1887, the founder of Celtic Football Club, Brother Walfred, made the journey to the Mealy family home in Cathcart to meet Tom Mealy, but he was out entertaining a lady. Walfred's journey, however, was not wasted, as he recruited Tom's younger brother, Willie, to be one of the club's first midfielders and eventually head coach. He held the position for an incredible 43 years, from 1897 to 1940. Winning 16 league titles and 14 Scottish Cups. As a manager, he was revolutionary. Celtic had been a buying club in their opening decade, and Willie instilled what became known as the Celtic Way, by recruiting players through youth development and building them as athletes and as men. He lived by his mantra, it's not the creed nor the nationality that counts, it's the man himself. He died in 1950 of arteriosclerosis, and incredibly, his name was not initially included in the inscription. But thanks to the Celtic Grave Society, this was later added. At the peak of the cemetery lies the first manager of Rangers Football Club, William Wilton. He joined as a player for the Rangers Swifts, their second team, in 1883, and became manager when they became a limited company in 1899, a position he held until his death in 1920. At the time of his death, he was spending the weekend with associates on a yacht in Gourock. In the early hours of the 3rd of May, heavy winds battered the yacht against the Gourock pier. The party of five climbed the mast to make the jump to the shore, and all succeeded but William, injuring himself in the fall and disappearing into the depths of the Clyde. His body was recovered in the following days further along the river, and he was buried in Cathcart Cemetery. As a manager, he won 8 league titles and 1 Scottish Cup, and is buried at one of the most picturesque spots in the cemetery. As lockdown and travel restrictions continued, people were forced to make the most of their local area. I wanted to know if this was something Peter had noticed and get his thoughts on this new wave of visitors to the cemetery.
I've definitely noticed over the last year that the cemetery has become much busier with visitors. And I think that can partly be put down to this phenomenon, this media phenomenon of tombstone tourism. Now, I think that partly it's got a longer ancestry than some people realise. The British, for a long time, have been very attracted to the idea of ruins. Wordsworth would write poetry about them and so on. But more recently, the advent of social media has allowed us to come to a cemetery like this and to whip out our phone from our back pocket and take a picture of interesting looking stones. So, for example, an angel which is missing a wing is more aesthetically interesting than a pristine angel. A cross with ivy growing up one side of it is more aesthetically interesting than a perfect cross the day that it came from the sculptor's yard. So I think Instagram and other social media has really allowed for this kind of boom in tombstone tourism to happen. But also, there's just so many fascinating stories to discover. I mean, these places are essentially libraries of the dead. And I can't blame people for coming here and trying to take some of these spines off the shelves.
One of the most attractive spines, and certainly the grandest grave the cemetery has to offer, is this one. It's the Hood Mausoleum, carved from pink granite, that the designer based on Trajan's kiosk in Egypt. William Hood was a butcher and the owner of Alexander Thompson's villa, The Knowe, which he renamed Nile Park. I couldn't help but think there was such an element of vanity to being buried in a tomb of this size, so I wanted to get Peter's thoughts.
These sorts of places, these sorts of tombs, are status symbols. You know, they demonstrate, the Victorians used these to demonstrate not only the depth of their grief and the depth of their faith, but also the depth of their pockets. This was a way of saying, I was someone on the earth, and I'm still going to be someone, even though I'm now in the earth.
Only 10 metres from the Hood Mausoleum is the grave of Henrietta Leach Williams, who was a suffragette. She protested for women's voting rights, and even though she died over 110 years ago, the circumstances surrounding her death are all too familiar.
What supposedly happened was that she was involved in what are known as the Black Friday protests in London in late 1910. She was very badly manhandled by the police, and as a result of which it's thought that she later died. Her body was brought back from London up to Glasgow on the train because she had family here, and she was buried in this spot in 1911. It was almost apparently like a kind of military funeral. The suffragette colours of white, green and purple on the flags were laid across the coffin, and suffragettes laid flowers at the grave. It's incredible to think about that happening on this very spot in 1911. And as you can see, she hasn't been forgotten. People have come here recently and they've left flowers. They've left ribbons in the suffragette colours. So this is a story that for a long time was forgotten, but it has been rediscovered recently. And that's just one of the brilliant things about this place. These stories are just waiting here to be picked up.
One thing that had really surprised me was the variety of stories and cultures here, given that Cathcart was a relatively small suburb all those years ago. One of my personal favourites was this man, George Henry, a well-travelled and extremely talented painter. George studied at the School of Art and was a part of a group of modernist painters called the Glasgow Boys. They took inspiration from all over the world, but George's was mainly from the time that he spent in Japan. He lived an incredible life and he died in 1943 as an elected member of the Royal Scottish Academy of Art. On my hunt for stories, I left the old section of the cemetery behind, split by an elderly road, and spent some time in the more recent Hebrew section that has limited opening hours. I had never really wandered around here before, and I was immediately taken aback by how different the layout was and how well it had been maintained compared to the old section. The first and most incredible character that I came across was Marianne or Mozzie Grant. She was born in Prague in 1921 and was an artist and a Holocaust survivor. During the Second World War, she survived three concentration camps and was saved by her artistic talent. She was the personal painter of the notorious SS doctor Josef Mengele and was ordered to sketch death camp prisoners for him. Later in her life, she wrote a book called I Knew I Was Painting for My Life. She eventually moved to Glasgow where she started a family and remained here until her death. A truly remarkable woman. The Hebrew section is rich with artistic characters, another one of which is Hannah Frank Levy. She was a talented artist and sculptor who spent most of her life studying and working in Glasgow. During the war, her art reflected the mood of the Jewish community at the time, and it reached a wide audience over the years. She died at the grand old age of 100 years old. The last story that I had researched was one of Glasgow's lesser known rock stars, Eric Wolfson, co-founder and vocalist of the Alan Parsons Project. Eric was born and raised in Glasgow and sold over 50 million albums in a successful career, and is another in a long list of incredible stories that makes us so lucky to have access to such an interesting cemetery.
Since lockdown, since the first lockdown in 2020, I've been walking in this cemetery even more than I had been before. I was using it as my daily exercise every single day. The reason for that was partly because the local parks were so busy with people that it was quite difficult to use them and to socially distance. So I took to walking in the cemetery as a way of, you know, getting some space, getting some exercise. But also, I think there's probably something deeper emotionally and psychologically going on, which is something that I've noticed in other people using the cemetery as well, because it's become massively more popular over the last 12 months, over the period of coronavirus and lockdown. And I think that is that people come to a place like this to seek some kind of solace and comfort, albeit unconsciously, at a time when death is so much in the news and in the air. I think there's a feeling of solidarity and even neighbourliness being in a cemetery, being surrounded by the multitudes of the dead who have gone through this whole experience before. And I think you can sense on some level the kind of friendly arm around your shoulder and the sort of murmured word in your ear that everything's going to be okay.